general purpose input output. Already we have studied all of these things. So already we have studied what is general purpose input output in NPC 2148. Okay, then we have to study what is pin connect block. So this particular functionality is also we have studied in NPC 2148. Then you have to interface your RGB LED. Okay, it's a red, green, blue LED to your Cortex M3 series. So these are some of the interfacing you have to study with the Cortex M3 series. The first interfacing is interfacing of RGB LED with a Cortex M3 series. Then you have to interface your 7-segment display to Cortex M3. Then you have to interface your TFT screen to your Cortex M3. And also you have to see how motor can be controlled using PWM. Okay, so this 1, 2, 3, 4, at least 4 to 5 interfaces are there for Cortex M3 series. Okay, not all other interfacing you have to study, but this whatever the specific interfacing that is mentioned in the this particular syllabus that you have to study. Okay, and this unit is quite simple. Okay, so basically this unit is included in the third year syllabus of your advanced processor, but in that syllabus they have excluded this unit, and then they have included this unit in the final year. Okay, that is in final year subject embedded system and RTOS. Okay, so this particular unit is very much similar to your NPC 2148. Okay, so only some of the changes that you have to monitor, and accordingly you have to remember those changes. Okay, I think it is clear what we have to study in this unit. Okay, this is one point. Again, I will make it more specific. Okay, representing. Okay, so before we go to the points or the actual points of your unit number 4, you have to submit this assignment number 4. Okay, so unit number 4 called as Advanced Embedded Architecture, that is nothing but the Cortex M3 M4 processor. So in this
screen,
hello Onkar, is there any problem?
Haan sir, screen dikhat nahi hai.
Screen dikhat nahi ka? I have shared this
sir, this is
sir. Okay, no problem. In unit number 4 you have to concentrate on these important points. So the first question or first point is this one, that is draw and explain block diagram of LPC 1768 in detail. So basically this is again your microcontroller from ARM series. Only the thing is that this is a very high end microprocessor or microcontroller from your ARM series called as a Cortex series. Okay, like your LPC 2148, you have to download the data sheets of LPC 1768, which is called as a Cortex M3 or M4 processor. Okay, and you have to draw its block diagram, and you have to explain each block. Okay, then second question is you have to explain the role of the following registers in LPC 1768. These registers also we have studied in the previous LPC 148 ARM7 processor. So first register is a direction register called as a FIO direction, that is fast input output direction control register. Second register is a set register. FIO set means fast input output set register. Clear register, FIO CLR, fast input output clear registers. Mask register, fast input output mask registers. Okay, So again, these four registers are again very much similar to your GPIO. If you remember, set register, clear register, direction registers. Okay. So these functionalities are also similar to your LPC2.1 for it. Okay. That means both the controllers are very much similar to each other. If you understand the first one, LPC2.1 for it, then you can easily understand the LPC1768, that is a Cortex-M processor. Okay, there are very few changes that you have to monitor and remember. Next question is again, draw and explain clock control block of LPC1768 in detail. So this is also a very important point regarding your gate number 4, that is clock control block. Okay, there are three. There's our question. Explain three clock sources for LPC1768. Okay, so this is our question to this. So here, clock control block of LPC1768 is very important in this unit. Then question number 4 is draw and explain power control block of LPC1768 and explain power saving modes. Okay, so either they will ask like this, draw and explain power control block of LPC and explain power saving modes, or they will ask you the another question, that is explain the different power saving modes like sleep mode, okay, then deep sleep mode, then power down mode and deep power down mode. So these are the four power saving and power saving modes of your Cortex-M3 processor. So there is a direct questions or indirect questions on this particular topic, like explain the power control block or explain the different power saving modes. Okay. Then question number 5 is about interfacing peripherals to your Cortex-M3. So here the first question they will definitely ask is draw and explain with algorithm interfacing diagram for RGB LED with LPC2.1768. So here you have to interface RGB LED and not a simple LED. Okay, RGB LED means the LED is a single LED, and inside that single LED there are three LEDs, red, green and blue. Okay, so as you change the current, the light of that LED get changed from red to green, green to blue. Okay, so three LEDs are included in a single LED called as a RGB LED. So you have to just draw that interfacing diagram and you have to turn on those LEDs on and off. Okay, so that is what the simple program, and also write an embedded C program for the same. Okay, so that means you have to interface the RGB LED to your LPC2.1 for it. You have to draw the diagram and also you have to write a code for the same. Okay, second interfacing is of PWM. Okay, so second question is what is PWM, pulse width modulation, and you have to write an embedded C program to drive DC motor using PWM for LPC1768. Okay, the yachat kay karayche tumhala, you have to interface this DC motor and you have to control the speed of your DC motor by using pulse width modulation. Okay, we know that pulse width modulation is nothing but the your on time and off time of DC motor can be controlled by using the your PWM. So that you have to achieve in this question number 6. So question number 6 is nothing but interfacing of your DC motor and controlling the speed of DC motor by using the PWM. Then very important question, that is question number 7. Here you have to explain the following blocks. Okay, so out of this first block is very important, called as a nested vector interrupt controller, NVIC, nested vector interrupt controller, and MPU, memory protection unit. So your LPC1768 having a very special features. The first feature or first service is called as a NVIC. So it have nested vector interrupt controllers, and also it having a memory protection unit. That means the memory of your LPC1768 can be protected. Okay, that kind of features are not available for ARM7. So these are the some of the very important features that might be asked for writing, okay, in the theory exam. So these 7 questions are very important, and you have to target on this 7 to 8 questions only. Okay. I hope you understood this. Here you have to give the main focus. Okay. Otherwise, it's very lengthy data sheet of your LPC 1768. You have to concentrate on only these points. We go for the if you have any problem, let me know. Okay, fine. So hello. Hello, kai problem hai ka?
Sir.
Hello. Aiku yet nahi tumcha awaaz. हेलो कुतुळ सायली कुतुळ बोलतात ना हॅलो
मॅम नो सर सर काकडे
काकडे आहेत का बरं ठीक आहे काकडे बोला
सर तुम्ही गुगल क्लासरूमला 7 शेअर केले त्याच्यात
गुगल क्लासरूमला काय शेअर केले
7-4 केले त्याच्यात 5 क्वेश्चन आहेत
हो हो त्याच्यात 5 क्वेश्चन बरोबर इथं 7 आहेत ना हॅलो हा बरोबर आहे मी कमी केले क्वेश्चन तुमच्यासाठी हा क्वेश्चन कमी केलेले असाइनमेंट साठी 5 केलेत बट इफ युअर एक्झाम मे बी इफ इट इज थेअरी देन यू हॅव टू कॉन्सन्ट्रेट ऑन अदर क्वेश्चन ऑल्सो ओके म्हणजे जेवढे मॅक्झिमम वेटेज आहे त्या युनिटला त्याच्यावरचे काही क्वेश्चन्स आलेत ते मी याच्यामध्ये ठेवलेले आहेत असाइनमेंट नंबर 7 मध्ये पण ॲज अ स्टँडर्ड असाइनमेंट म्हणून सगळ्या 5-5-6-6 क्वेश्चनचे दिलेले आहेत मी ठीक आहे तो काही इश्यू नाही आहे फक्त लक्ष ठेवा की हे हे पॉईंट्स आपल्याला कव्हर करायचे या युनिटमध्ये ठीक आहे इज इट ओके आय थिंक इट्स ओके ओके नाऊ वी गो टू द ऍक्च्युअली युनिट नंबर 4 ओके वी विल सी सम ऑफ द टर्म्स वी हॅव 30 मिनिट्स and we have seen on which point we have to concentrate okay so these are the points on which you have to concentrate it's very simple okay that is data sheets interfacing that is LPC 1768 feature okay this one this is important part regarding your exam okay then system control block clock power control and interfacing diagram this so these three parts these three topics are very very important regarding your exams okay now we will see some of the features of Cortex M3 processor okay so development of the ARM architecture I don't want to this explain but let's go to the actual point okay now just see this particular table shows the comparison of ARM 7 TDMIS. If you remember in your third year, second semester, we have that subject, advanced processor. Here you have to study the ARM 7 in detail. So what is the long form of this ARM 7? You just see. ARM 7 Advanced RISC Machine Core 7 okay, TDMIS. Okay. So this is what the ARM 7 we have studied. Now we have to compare the very high end processor or advanced processor of this ARM 7 called as a Cortex M3 processor. Okay, so if you compare Cortex M3 processor with your ARM 7 with some of the features like first feature, just see architecture. So if you take the first feature as an architecture, ARM 7 TDMIS uses this ARM version 4, T for thumb. Okay, remember this advanced RISC machine version 4 T for thumb and it uses the von Neumann type of architecture. You know what is von Neumann architecture, where data and instruction bus get shared to each other. So the speed of this is quite low or slow compared to the Cortex M3 processor. So in now Cortex M3 processor, you just observe it's a ARM version 7, okay, advanced RISC machine version 7-M, okay, and it having a Harvard architecture. Okay, now what happened with Harvard architecture? We have a separate instruction bus as well as data bus. So that will increase the speed of our communication. So that is what the advantage with the Harvard architecture, because of separate instruction and data bus. Okay, the speed of the overall speed of the Cortex M3's increase. Okay, so we are going to get the first advantage over the ARM 7 type of controllers because of use of Harvard architecture. Now second feature is called as a ISA support. So ARM 7 TDMIs having two types of instructions. One is called as a thumb instruction set and second is called as a ARM instruction set. Okay, so thumb instruction set is called as a 16 bit and ARM instruction set is a 32 bit size. Okay, so if your program is of only 16 bit, you can use thumb state or thumb instructions, and if your instructions are of 32 bit size, you can use ARM instructions. Now however, in Cortex M3 there is a one more instruction set is included called as a thumb 3. Okay, that means in Cortex M3 there is no ARM instruction set, rather than they have the thumb and thumb 2 instruction set. So thumb is again 16 bit instruction set, here thumb 2 is a 16 bit as well as 32 bit instruction. That means this thumb 2 can handle both type of instruction, that is 16 bit as well as 32 bit instruction. So that is what the advantage of this thumb 2 over the only thumb and ARM instruction set. So this second features also give you more advantages in terms of the code density and the performance compared to the ARM 7. Okay, that means if we use thumb 2 type of instructions, thumb 2 type of instructions could give you more code density as well as it will give you more performance compared to the thumb and ARM instruction set of ARM 7. Okay. Then third features of your ARM 7 is a pipeline. Now ARM 7, we know that this is a three-stage pipeline. Okay. However, if you use a Cortex M3 type of processor, it having a three-stage pipelining. Okay. Plus it having branch speculation. Okay. That means branch-related operations also can be executed in a pipeline. In a pipeline by using a Cortex M3 series. So Cortex M3 series also get the advantage in this feature, that is in terms of pipelining also, it is more advantageous compared to the ARM 7. Then comes to the next point, that is the interrupts. So interrupts, we have FIQ and IRQ interrupts for ARM 7, fast interrupts as well as normal interrupts, IRQ. Now, for Cortex M3, you see, you have more number of interrupts called as a NMI, called as a non-maskable interrupts, plus 1 to 240 physical interrupts. Okay, that means more number of interrupts are available for Cortex M3 series, that is from 1 to 40. Okay, so for ARM 7, we don't have that much of interrupts available. And we know what is the role of the interrupts. So interrupts are very important whenever we have to execute the very urgent work. Okay, so interrupts are very important. So more the interrupts, then it is possible to execute your more number of real time requests. Okay, so whenever we are going to implement a hard real time systems, at that time you can use Cortex M3 type of processors. Okay. Then fifth feature is a interrupt latency. You know what is interrupt latency? Interrupt latency is nothing but the time required to respond to the given request. Okay, if some interrupt has given the request to the processor, so how much time is required by the processor to respond to the that interrupt request? So that is called as an interrupt latency. And we observe that in ARM 7,
the interrupt latency is of 24 cycles, 242 cycles, which is very high. Okay, that means if any interrupt comes to ARM7, okay, it requires at least 24 cycles minimum and 42 cycles maximum to respond to the given interrupts, which is not a good sign. Okay, because we are working for a hard real-time system where the deadlines are very important. That means you have to execute your task in a very few seconds or in milliseconds. However, ARM7 will take more times. Okay, now how to deal with this issue? We can deal with this issue by using the Cortex M3 processor, where the interrupt latency is of only 12 cycles. Okay, you can compare, just see, it is half of that ARM7. It requires 24 cycles and Cortex M3 requires only 12 cycles. Okay, so in this way, Cortex M3 will reduce the interrupt latency and will respond to the interrupt in a very short span of time. So that is also the advantages. So all these five advantages, means Cortex M3 shows all the five advantages on the ARM7. Then next sixth feature is a sleep modes. Okay. Now ARM7 doesn't have a sleep modes. Okay. That is none. Sleep modes are not available to ARM7. However, for Cortex M3 processor, we have integrated modes. Okay, right now we have seen that is deep mode, sleep mode, deep sleep mode. This right now we have seen in the assignment. Okay, so there are four different sleep modes or power saving modes available for Cortex M3 processor, which is not available to the ARM7. That means ARM7 will consume more power compared to the Cortex M3 series. So that is also the advantages. So in terms of power consumption, Cortex M3 is very good compared to the ARM7 because it having a different power saving modes. Then next feature is a memory protection unit. This memory protection unit, now ARM7 have no memory protection unit. That means you cannot protect your memory. However, for Cortex M3 processor, it having 8 region memory protection unit. That means you can protect your memory from other users. Okay, otherwise what happen, anybody can read your code from the memory. Okay, so it is possible to protect your code from other users also. Okay, for being readable or writable, or it may be reproducible code. Okay, so these things can be avoided if you protect your code from the memory. So this kind of very important service or protection is provided by the Cortex M3 processor, which is not available in the ARM7. The next feature is a dry stone. Okay, dry stone means that is mega instructions executed per seconds. Okay, so ARM7 can execute 0.95 dry stone mega instructions per seconds, that is DMIPS per megahertz. Okay, in the ARM mode. However, Cortex M3 can execute 1.25 dry stone mega instructions per seconds per megahertz. Okay, that means Cortex M3 will execute more number of instructions compared to the ARM7. So that is directly shown by this two digit, that is 0.95 and 1.25. So Cortex M3 will outperform the ARM7 in terms of the number of instructions executed. Okay, per seconds or per megahertz. Okay. Then next, the next feature is a power consumption. Now we can observe here ARM7. It requires 0.28 milliwatt per megahertz. Okay, so per megahertz, 0.28 milliwatt per megahertz is the power consumed by the ARM7. However, if you observe Cortex M3 processor, it will consume only 0.19 milliwatt per megahertz. Okay, that means at least 0.01% is a lesser power consumption is taken by the Cortex M3 processor. Okay. So these two values, 0.28 and 0.19, that will directly shows that ARM7 will consume more power compared to the Cortex-M3 processor. Okay. So in this feature also, your Cortex-M3 will overcome over the ARM7. And very last feature is the area that is the total area, footprint area of your IC. So ARM7 will require 0.62 mm square, okay, and that is only the core of your ARM7 only. Okay, so only core of ARM7 will require 0.62 mm square of area. However, Cortex M3 processor requires 0.86 mm square. Okay, even though it is more compared to ARM7, 0.62 is lesser one and 0.86 is higher one, but if you compare it correctly, the Cortex M3 having both the core as well as peripherals. Okay, that means the core as well as all the peripherals area is only 0.86 mm square, compared to only the area of your ARM7, which is requires 0.62. okay, so again, this feature will again outperform your ARM7. Okay, so if you compare all these features with ARM7, Cortex M3 processor will completely outperform your ARM7, and this is the reason why Cortex M3s are widely used in the high-end applications. Okay, in mobile phones also. Is it audible all? Visible and audible? Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now some of the other features we will compare with your ARM7 and Cortex M3. Okay, so this is very important. Before we go in detail for Cortex M3, you should know the difference between the Cortex M3 and the your previous one, that is ARM7. Now, next feature is a interrupt controller. Okay, so interrupt controller having external peripherals for ARM7. Okay, however, for Cortex M3, it having integrated peripherals, that is called as a NVIC, nested vector interrupt controller. Okay, then hardware stacks. Now we have seen for ARM7 there are different modes of operations, like FIQ mode, IRQ mode, supervisor mode, user mode, abort mode, undefined mode. Okay, however, for Cortex M3 series having only two mode, called as a process plus main. Okay, so there are two modes only, process plus main. And for ARM7, we have seen there are seven modes, some privileged mode and some non-privileged mode. Then OS operating system timer, ARM7 having external peripherals. However, Cortex M3 having its internal peripheral called as a system tick. Okay, means we don't need the external clock. It having its own internal clock called as a system tick. Then context switch, MUCOS 2. If you use MUCOS 2, then context switch time is up to 50 to 73 instructions. Okay, for ARM7, and if you use Cortex M3 processor, it requires only 29 instructions. Okay. That means to switch from one task to another task, okay, ARM7 requires at least a minimum 50 and maximum 73 instructions. But if you use Cortex M3 to switch from one task to another task, it requires only 29 instructions. Okay, so it will directly shows that the use of Cortex M3 will speed up the overall operations of your system, and also provide a number of advantages compared to the ARM7. So this is the reason why Cortex M3 is preferred over the ARM7. Okay, so in the exam, they might ask you to compare your Cortex M3 processor with the ARM7. So that's why this is very important point. Okay. Now, some of the improvement over classical series are shown here. Okay. That is architecture block, ARM classic series, ARM 9, 10, 11, and then Cortex M3 processor. So there are different features that are added into the architecture, like core instruction, tightly coupled memory, and number of blocks are added. So one more point that we have seen just right now, that is processor modes. Okay, so processor mode, now Cortex M3 processor having only two modes, called as a thread and the handler. Okay, however, classical series ARM7 having the user mode, supervisor mode. Okay, then we have system mode, then have undefined mode. Okay, then abort mode, FIQ and IRQ. I think you are going to remember this. Okay, so these are the different operating modes of your ARM7, and there are only two operating modes of your Cortex M3 processor. Okay, so all these are the comparison points in detail again. Okay, just say Cortex M3 is compared with the classical series, exception that is your interrupts. Okay, some other comparisons are also shown. Okay, so we come across this. Okay, so industry standard, ARM Cortex M processors are global microcontroller standards, having been licensed to over 40 ARM partners, including leading vendors such as, that means this Cortex M3 are licensed by this 40 ARM partners, which are, this is a first, is a Freescale, okay, NXP means Philips, ST Microelectronics, Texas Instruments, Toshiba, Microchip, Analog Devices, Silicon Labs, and Spanier. So all those different companies manufacture Cortex M3 type of processors. Okay, now we come across the theoretical part of your Cortex M3 processor. So what is the ARM Cortex M3 processor? So we have to see some of the answers. So ARM Cortex M3 processor is nothing but the first of the Cortex generation of the processors released by ARM in 2006, which is primarily designed to target the 32-bit microcontroller market. Okay, so basically Cortex M3 is invented to replace the 32-bit microcontroller in the market. So that is what the basic objective. The Cortex M3 processor provides excellent performance at low gate count and comes with many new features previously available only in high-end processors. Okay, so why Cortex M3 processors is used? So this is the reason. The ARM Cortex M3 processors are used to replace the previously 32-bit microcontroller in the market. This is the first reason why they have launched. And what are the advantages of Cortex M3 that we have to see one by one? The first advantage is that it having an excellent performance, okay, at low gate count, means with a lesser amount of devices, with having a higher performance, and also it will provide you a very high end features. Okay, then next is the Cortex M3 addresses the requirements for the 32 embedded processor market in the following ways. Okay, just see what are the basic advantages of your Cortex M3. So first advantage is this one. This is called as a greater performance efficiency. Okay, what is the, if anybody ask you what is the what are the main advantages of Cortex M3 processor, so this is the first advantage, that is Cortex M3 processor provide you the greater performance efficiency, allowing more work to be done without increasing the frequency or power requirements. Okay, greater performance efficiency means it will execute more number of instructions that we have seen. Okay, that is Dristone mega instructions per seconds. Okay, compared to the your conventional ARM7 type of processor. So it having higher performance efficiency, that means it can execute more number of instructions per seconds per megahertz compared to your ARM7. Okay, and at without increasing the frequency or power requirement. So that's why this is the important
advantage of your Cortex-M3 processor. That is, it provides greater performance efficiency without increasing the frequency or power requirements. Now, the second important advantage of Cortex-M3 processor is a low power consumption. Okay. Now, a low power consumption will enable longer battery life, especially in critical in portable products, including wireless networking applications. Okay. So another advantage of Cortex-M3 processor is its low power consumption. That means this controller will consume very less power, okay, compared to the previously designed ARM7 type of microcontroller. Okay. So since it consumes less power, then it is very very easy to power your battery life for a longer time, and whatever the devices that are very critical in your success of your systems, so like some wireless applications, so they can take a power for a longer time. So that is what the advantage of this feature, that is a low power consumption. Now, the third advantage of Cortex-M3 processor is enhanced determinism. Okay, enhanced determinism means it having guaranteeing that critical tasks and interrupts are serviced as quickly as possible and in a known number of cycles. Determinism means deterministic. That means the response of all the tasks and interrupts is deterministic. Okay, it is not random. Okay. So before the execution of your task or the interrupt, already we know that how much time is required to execute that task, as well as how much time is required to execute that interrupt. So this time is already deterministic. So that is called as a enhanced determinism. Means your Cortex-M3 will guarantee that your critical task and interrupts are serviced as quickly as possible and in a known number of cycles. Okay, so that is what the advantage of with this Cortex-M3 processor. Now, the fourth advantage of your Cortex-M3 processor is a improved code density. Okay, so try to understand the word. What is code density? Code density is nothing but number of instructions that are fitted into the memory. Okay, so Cortex-M3 having the improved code density means ensuring that code fits in even the smallest memory footprint. Okay, so increasing the code density means this is nothing but you have to fit more number of instructions in a very small size. Okay, so that is called as a code density. Code density means you have more number of instructions, but you have to fit into the smaller area. So if you are able to fit higher number of instruction into the small area, then that is called as a that area having a very good code density. Okay, so in terms of Cortex-M3 processor, as we know that we have the number of instructions or mega instructions, so we have to fit all those mega instructions into a small memory footprint, that is on a memory. So this is what the next feature called as improved code density means, ensuring that your code fits in even the smallest memory footprint. Okay, that means even though the memory is small, still your whatever the code that should be fittable, okay, into that memory footprints. So this is one of the very good features provided by the Cortex-M3 processor, which will provide you the very good code density. Okay. The next advantage is of ease of use. Cortex-M3 is very easy to use. It will providing easier programmability and debugging for the growing number of 8-bit and 16-bit users migrating to 32 bits. Okay, that means Cortex-M3 is easy to use. It is not complex. Okay. Since it is easy, more number of users can switch from 8 to 16 bit to the 32 bit. So that is what the advantage with the Cortex-M3. Next advantage with Cortex-M3 is a lower
cost solutions. Okay, so reducing 32-bit based system cost close to those of legacy 8-bit and 16-bit devices, and enabling low-end 32 microcontroller to be priced at less than US $1 for the first time. Okay, that means Cortex M3 processors, the cost of this Cortex M3 processor is reduced such that the cost of this 32-bit processor is very much equal to the cost of the 8-bit or 16-bit devices or microcontrollers. Okay, so if the cost, overall cost is reduced compared to your 32-bit, okay, so more number of customers can purchase this particular IC. Okay, so lower cost solution means the overall cost of this Cortex M3 processor is very much less, and it is very much equal to the price of the 8-bit or 16-bit type of microcontroller. Even the Cortex M3 is a 32-bit microprocessor, but if you compare the cost of this processor is very much similar to the cost of your lower end 8-bit or 16-bit devices. So that will enable the user to use more number of Cortex M3 type of processors. Then wide choice of development tool. Okay, next advantage with Cortex M3 is a wide choice of development tools. That is, from low cost or free compilers to full feature development suits from many development tool vendors. Okay, so already we know that development tools like compiler, interpreter, okay, then cross compilers likewise. So you have wide choice for development tools. Okay, from low cost or free compilers are also available to develop the code for Cortex M3 processors. So these are some of the very important advantages of your Cortex M3 over the ARM7. Okay, now some of the very important features that we'll discuss in this slide. So here is shown as advanced three-stage pipeline. Okay, so as we know that instruction fetch, instruction decode, and instruction execute. So these are the three stages of the any instruction execution. The processor fetches the branch instruction during the decode stage itself. Later during the execute stage, the branch is resolved and it is known which instruction is to be executed next. Okay. Now this is what done in a three-stage pipeline by ARM7, but in Cortex M3 it will do the advanced three-stage pipeline as well as it would do the branch speculation, that is branch prediction. That means branch related operations are also executed in this particular feature. Okay, and then Harvard architecture, already we know that the central Cortex M3 core is based on the Harvard architecture, characterized by separate buses for instructions and data. Okay, so since Cortex M3 uses hardware architecture, whose meaning is nothing but to use a separate buses for instruction and data, which will increase the overall speed of the execution. Okay. Some of the operating modes of your Cortex M3 processor that we have seen, that right now there are only two modes. The Cortex M3 processor supports only two operating modes and two privilege levels. So first operating mode is called as a thread mode, and second is called as a handler mode. Okay, so when the processor is running in thread mode, it can be either the privileged or user level. Handlers can only be in the privileged level. On reset, it is in thread mode with privileged access rights. Okay, so thread are also called as the interrupts. Okay, so there are two modes, operating modes of Cortex M3, thread mode and handler modes. Okay. So this is what software infrastructure is shown for. Then there is a concept called as a nested vector interrupt controller, NVIC. Okay. Now in Cortex M3, there are two types of instruction sets. One is called as thumb 2 instruction set, and one is called as a thumb instruction set. Okay, so I will just show you. I will take 1 minute only. You just observe this. There are three types of instruction sets. One is called as an arm given by this color. Okay, then thumb 2 and thumb. Okay, now what happened in arm 7? You have the arm instruction set and the thumb instruction set. Whereas in Cortex M3, you don't have the arm instruction set. Rather than you have only thumb 2 and thumb. Now, what is the advantage of thumb 2 over arm and thumb that we have to see? Okay, so if you observe, this is arm, thumb 2 and thumb. And this is what the thumb 2 performance is 25 faster than thumb. So this comparison shows that 1, 2, 3, that is your thumb 2 type of instruction set performance is 25% faster than the thumb. Okay, that means Cortex M3 processor having 25% faster performance compared to the R7 if you use the thumb 2 type of instruction set. Similarly, in this area also, if you observe, thumb 2 code size is 26% smaller than R. Okay, that means thumb 2 type of instruction will compress more number of instructions into a small area compared to the ARM7. Okay, so that is what shown. Thumb 2 code size is 26% smaller than ARM. Okay, so in this way, thumb 2 will outperforms your ARM7 by both the way, okay, in terms of code density as well as in terms of the performance. So this is the reason why Cortex M3 will performs better compared to the ARM7. Okay, so it's a